Okay, the final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 2397 in the name of Emma Harper on potential for Dumfries city status. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I would urge members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Emma Harper to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is the final members' debate of this year, and I hope we can end this term on a positive, consensual note, doing something I greatly enjoy, and that's shining a big muckle light on the southwest of Scotland and my hometown, Dumfries. I thank members who have signed my motion allowing the debate to go ahead today. Presiding Officer, 2022 presents an exciting opportunity as part of Her Majesty's Platinum Jubilee for towns across the UK to receive city status. Her Majesty appoints new cities. When I picked this opportunity up with Mark Jardine and the Dumfries People's Project in June this year, I brought together an initial meeting of stakeholders. This included local elected members, council officials, community councils, organisations, community leaders, the Lord Lieutenant and deputies of Dumfries and many others. From this meeting came the realisation that there existed many preconceptions about what makes a town qualify to be a city. So before I extol the virtues of Dumfries and our wider region, I first want to do some myth-busting. Questions have been asked. The first myth, don't you need to have a cathedral? The answer is no. That is not... Willie Coffey's laughing because he asked me the same question 10 minutes ago. It's not a requirement to be a city, although we do have an amazing red sandstone church on the Crichton campus. It's an awfully braw place to visit. The second myth, Presiding Officer, is Dumfries isn't big enough. The answer, there is no population requirement for city status award. Dumfries has a population of 48,229 people, which is more than the 16 cities that already have city status, including Stirling and Perth. Other issues have been raised. You can't be a city because there are too many seagulls and too many empty shops. Sadly, all cities are tackling the same issues of empty shops, vacant, abandoned and also derelict buildings. And these matters are being and can be addressed if we aspire to do that. Of course I'll give way.
Bob Doris.
I thank the member for giving way. Could I just put on record that I spent part of my summer holidays in Dumfries? I thoroughly enjoyed it and it felt like a city to me. So good luck in your endeavours.
Emma Harper.
I thank Bob Doris for that intervention, and as Bob Doris has spent his summer in Dumfries, I would encourage all members to do that, because it is a bonny place. We have had the issues raised of our empty shops and our vacant and abandoned and derelict buildings, but having an aspiration to attract inward investment and inward migration to improve the town, that has been seen already in Perth, Stirling and Inverness. When they became cities, that will help tackle many of these issues that I have already highlighted. Even just making the city bid application has led to conversations about what needs to be done to address the issues that I've highlighted, and even some positive publicity does help. Presiding Officer, I want to turn to why Dumfries, the town that I'm proud to live in, which has cultural, social, innovative and environmental attributes, is worthy of city status. Dumfries is the home of Robert Burns, it's the birthplace of Peter Pan, it's the place that led Robert the Bruce to become King of Scotland. Dumfriesshire is also the home of the Savings Bank founder, Henry Duncan, the father of modern physics, James Clerk Maxwell, civil engineer Thomas Telford, the invention of the first bicycle by Kirkpatrick Macmillan, the father of the American Navy, John Paul Jones, the Galloway car, which was made for women by women at Tongland and Locker Briggs, artists Jesse Marion King and Edward Hornell, musician Ray Wilson of Genesis fame, actor Sam Heughan, a lot of the lassies will know him, and John Laurie and the cult classic film The Wicker Man. And we can never forget local Dumfries lad Calvin Harris. Dumfries has a long history and some great stories and great characters. And we even have in our own ancient breed a Kai, the world famous Belty Galloway. Of course I will take an intervention.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank Emma Harper for taking an intervention. She's listed lots of wonderful people from Dumfriesshire. None of those people needed city status to succeed. What is it about being a city that she feels is so important and so lacking at the moment?
Emma Harper.
I thank Mr Mundell for that, intervention, but I am coming to that. It's about aspiration, right? We boast a vibrant culture, a cultural scene with the Big Burn Supper, the Good Neighbours, the oldest working theatre in Scotland, the Theatre Royal, many arts, music and book festivals. Dumfries and Galloway has the UNESCO Biosphere, the world-recognised Dark Skies Park in the Galloway Forest, and hopefully will be the home of Scotland's next national park. All of D&G is an amazing outdoor green space adventure park. It's home to world-class facilities like the Seven Stains, mountain bike trails, the otter pools. Do I have time, Presiding Officer?
I can give you some of that time back.
Okay,
Ms.
thanks.
Alistair Allen. Dr. Allen, have you got your card in?
No, is that working?
Yes. Yeah.
I'm compelled to ask the member, thank her for giving way. After that last intervention, has she encountered any other opposition within Dumfries to the idea of city status, or is it just coming from over there?
Emma Harper.
It is just coming from over there, and there is a few folk that have been sceptical. I've invited all the sceptics, Dr. Allen. My door is open to have conversations with anybody about what they think the issues might be opposing this. So, you know, we have such opportunities, I think, you know, with our otter pools, our Seven Stains, our Bonnie Miles and Rivers, our lochs, the Solway Coast. It's an outdoor rural adventure if Bob Doris comes back to Dumfries and Galloway. Dumfries, as the first rural city in Scotland, it will have an amazing opportunity to pursue sustainable economic green recovery from the pandemic. Our world-leading food and drink sector, including local breweries, gin, whisky and rum distilleries, are also first-class visitor destinations and would hugely benefit from Dumfries becoming a city. Dumfries also has a worldwide innovation in medical history, with the first ever ether anaesthetic delivered in Europe in 1846 by Dr. Scott McLaughlin at Dumfries Infirmary. As a town, we satisfy the cultural, social, environmental, innovation criteria required for recognition to be Scotland's eighth city. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's agenda for cities, revised in 2016, states that we want a Scotland where our cities and our regions power Scotland's economy for the benefit of all. It was published before the realities of the Brexit harms, before they were known and before the COVID pandemic. And I'm keen to hear from the Minister what's next for this vision for cities, and is it being revised to show how Scotland's cities can help power economic recovery for our regions, bearing in mind that we will have one new city in Scotland by March 2022. All of these are reasons why Mark Jardine of the Dumfries People's Project and the complete support from the D&G Council with this bid led by the Provost Tracy Little submitted this bid to aid with economic recovery post-pandemic. The bid is also supported by local charities, businesses, our local schools, our young people, community groups and organisations like Dumfries and Galloway Housing Partnership. And Dumfries, which will be the first geographical city in Scotland when heading north and the only city in the South Scotland region, if it was awarded city status, it could increase tourism, attract business and bolster investment into the entire region. It will truly be the Queen of the South. I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer. One of the benefits of city status is good transport links with other cities and easy access to the varied beauty of our rural Scotland. And while many aspects of transport infrastructure across South Scotland, such as bus and train links, the A75 and the A77, we know they need improved, city status brings greater emphasis on these issues and will bring more attention to the need for roads investment. This will only be achieved through wider attention on our whole region. In conclusion, when Perth, Stirling and Inverness received city status, they went from strength to strength, with greater job creation, increased inward migration, increased visitor numbers and improved transport infrastructure to connect them with other cities. I want to see this benefit for Dumfries and our wider region, and I ask the Scottish Government to do all it can to help this aim so that Dumfries can be the newest Scottish city and the Queen of the South. I look forward to hearing colleagues' contributions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call on Oliver Mundell, who will be followed by Colin Smith. 4 minutes, please, Mr Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It probably doesn't need stated, but I am a committed monarchist and, God willing, wish to see Her Majesty reign over the United Kingdom for many years to come. And after what's set to be another dark winter, the Platinum Jubilee celebrations offer a ray of light at the end of the tunnel and will hopefully be an opportunity for all our communities to once again come together and rejoice in all that is good about our country. I say this as I don't want anything which follows to be seen as disrespectful to the royal family, who have been such great supporters of causes across Dumfriesshire, nor would I wish anything I say today to reflect negatively on the significant efforts of Mark Jardine, who through the People's Project has done so much for the town of Dumfries. However, the truth is none of the above, in my view, is a good enough reason to squander the main selling point of Dumfries as a market town and the hub of our rural community. We cannot and should not simply invent cities just to tick boxes. I would also question why, in a large rural region like Dumfries, why Dumfries was the automatic candidate. We've already heard that size of population is not a factor. So why not the royal city of Sanker? Or Langham the Muckle Toon could have been the Muckle City. Certainly.
Emma Harper.
Man, I think you should take a deep breath while I'm doing this intervention. We're not talking about a massive concrete metropolis. We're talking about an aspiration for the biggest town in the south, which can then spill out into the wider region. Do you not just have a bit of an aspiration for the south of Scotland to have one city?
Through the chair, please, Ms Harper. Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, President Officer. I'd say I'd have more aspiration for Dumfries than the SNP, who failed it, as I'll come on to later in my speech. We could have had Langham as the Muckle Toon, could become the Muckle City, but in a man who still bides in Dumfries, the true meaning of life is nay in Machin Muckle Mayor. Or we could have had the city of Newton Womfrey, or indeed even Gretna Green. This sounds like a flippant point, Presiding Officer, but I strongly object to the suggestion that you need to be a city to be successful, or that you need to live in a city to succeed. Instead of peddling in this panto season Dick Whittington-esque myths that only the city streets are lined with gold and not with rats and rubbish, as we see in Scotland's largest city, we should instead, and this is where I agree with Emma Harper, be confident in proudly making the case for why Dumfries is unique. Its sense of community, good neighbours, a gateway to much of our rural region, the good work-life balance, the history and culture, our connection to Burns, to Barry and Bruce, but to name a few. When the idea was first floated, many in the town believed it was an early April Fool's. Others came to the conclusion that the only reason politicians would be supporting it was because politicians in cities get paid more. Well, others simply concluded, certainly.
Christine Graham.
I note, Mr Mundell, that from the motion, the Lord Lieutenant of Dumfries supports this bid. Do you disagree with him?
Through the chair, please, Ms Graham. Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, President Officer. I wouldn't seek to compromise her role, but she's in a position where the council, which is made up of different political parties, has come to a position. I would find it odd if she wasn't duty-bound, but that doesn't mean that everyone supports it, far from it. Many people believe that the only reason it's being taken forward is to distract from all the other things that have not been taken forward. And I'd say to Christine Graham, as a directly elected representative, I'm not in the business of backing unpopular ideas. That's also why I oppose border posts and plastic currency to replace the pound. But I don't want to sound too much like Scrooge, or more than I have done already, and dismiss all of Emma Harper's best ideas before Christmas. In all seriousness, though, if we want to restore and increase pride in Dumfries and bring and keep future generations of Dunhamers at home, we need to focus on what will make a difference. For example, dueling the A75, ditching the £25 million bund on the White Sands and depedestrianising at least part of the High Street. In closing, Presiding Officer, I will respect the outcome of the competition process, but I would politely ask those assisting Her Majesty in identifying a winner to look for a candidate where there is widespread unanimous support, not one where opinion is divided at best.
Thank you, Mr Mundell. I now call on Colin Smith, who will be followed by Paul McLennan. Again, 4 minutes, please, Mr Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Emma Harper for tabling her motion. It's nice to hear someone from the Clyde Hole backing us Dunhamers, and I apologise to the official report who, not for the first time, be wondering what I'm talking about. But, Presiding Officer, Dumfries is my home. It's where I was born, it's where I've always lived, and it's where I bring up my family. And frankly, I wouldn't have it any other way. It's a town with a proud, rich history, and as we've already heard, including the three Bs. Burns, a national bard, had his last family home in Dumfries, where he wrote many of his finest works, including Auld Lang Syne. He frequented a few of the same houses as I do, such as the Globe Inn, as well as Scotland's oldest working theatre, the Dumfries Theatre Royal, and it's where in St Michael's Kirk Cemetery he was ultimately laid to rest. And we have Bruce, whose slaying of the Red Common in Dumfries Greyfriars Kirk led to him claiming the crown as King of Scots. And Barry, the author who studied at Dumfries Academy, where my own kids will go in a few years, and who was inspired to write Peter Pan in the magical Neverland Garden of Moat Bray in Dumfries, now home to the National Centre for Children's Literature and Storytelling. It's an example of how our town's proud past is cultivating a positive future, and there are many other examples. Nedger Town, the jewel in the crown, the 85-acre Crichton estate, originally Europe's biggest psychiatric hospital, is now home to the South's largest conference and events venue, a major business park, and a vibrant college and university campus with over 6,000 students. So, Presiding Officer, it's little wonder the Royal Borough of Dumfries is known as the Queen of the South, which is also, of course, the name of our local football team, which also has a proud past, and as a season ticket holder, I hope quite soon we'll have an even more positive future. I'll take an intervention on that. Yeah.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. I am thanking Colin Smith for taking an intervention because of the time constraints, and I know I went over. You have mentioned the football team, the Queen of the South, and the Crichton Estate, which is fantastic, so I really appreciate that. Does Colin Smith also agree that, you know, the places like the people, or people like the People's Project, Alive Radio, and lots of community support is out there for this, and the whole engagement process is about the community leading the whole city bid from day one?
Colin Smith.
I thank Emma Harper for that intervention. It is about the community, ultimately. It's about what I call my hame toon. And as Queen's fans of a same, Presiding Officer, your hame team's your own team. And what memories I've got supporting Queen of the South, such as the 2008 Scottish Cup final. Now, it didn't matter that we didn't actually win the game. Thousands of the Blue and White Army still proudly paraded through the town behind the open top team bus days after the game. And, of course, getting to that final led to Queen's only venture in Europe against Denmark's FC Nordsjælland. Now, I remember walking through the main street of Copenhagen in the days before that match, and I actually felt like you were walking through Dumfries. You stopped to chat to those people, so many familiar faces, good neighbour after good neighbour. And, Presiding Officer, as Emma Harper said, it's that community spirit, that friendliness, that really makes the town of Dumfries. And, yes, it would make the city of Dumfries. And the work of those community groups that have been mentioned, from the Mid-Steeple Quarter to the People's Project, really does encapsulate that pride we have in our town. Now, I don't know if city status bid will be successful. I know some people, as we've heard, might ask, is it worth it? It doesn't come with any extra funding, for example. And we are absolutely a very proud town. But I do know that the research suggests it can provide an economic boost to those who achieve city status, putting them on the map. And Dumfries has as good a case as anywhere to be a city. I'll take an intervention.
Jenny Minto.
Thank you. Like Bob Doris, I too have holidayed in Dumfries and like it. But would Colin Smith agree with me that Oban within Argyll and Bute is also a good contender for the newest city in Scotland?
Carefully, Mr Smith.
It was indeed. I have to say, Oban was the very first whisky distillery I visited many years ago. However, we do have the most recent one, or one of the most recent ones, at Annandale Distillery, very close to Dumfries. So maybe we could do a swap visit and holiday at some point in the future. But,
That's not careful, Mr Smith.
It's very uncareful. Moving on quickly, I want to thank those, therefore, behind the bid, Matt Jardine, the council, the community groups. But whatever the outcome, I hope that the process, the discussion we're having here about how we make Dumfries even better, keeps going after the bid, irrespective of whether we win it or not. There's a sign above my office here in Parliament which says Dunhamer, and in my first ever speech in this chamber 5 years ago, I told members that Dunhamer was the nickname for Queen of the South, but it was also the name for those of us from Dumfries. I explained its origins lay in the 19th century when many people from the town worked away from home, particularly on the railways in Glasgow, and they talked about coming back Dunheim to Dumfries. It's a term that's never been more apt, however, than it is today, because many of our towns and our regions, young people sadly still leave the area for the high-skilled, high-wage employment opportunities that are not always available Dunheim. That's the reason I stood for Parliament 5 years ago. We'd lost big manufacturing bases like ICI, Nestle, Uniroyal. I want to fight for better opportunities for our young people in what can often be a forgotten part of Scotland. It's why I campaigned, for example, for a decade as a councillor representing the Dumfries Town Centre Ward of Nith for a South of Scotland Enterprise Agency, which is now up and running. It's why I was part of those early days of the Borderlands Initiative that's now developed into the Borderlands Growth Deal. But so much more still needs to be done. So whether we win or lose the city status bid, this can't be the end of the debate on the future of Dumfries. Those who live there, who have a genuine stake in our town's future, want to see action and more opportunities for young people, improvements to our town centre. Ensuring we deliver that action, therefore, must be the legacy of this bid. Presiding officer, I said at the start, Dumfries is where I was born, and it's where I've always lived. Now, whether we're a proud town or we become a city, I suspect that will always be the case for me, and I'd be more than happy with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Smith. I now call on Paul McLennan, who will be followed by Finlay Carson. 4 minutes, Mr McLennan.
Deputy President Officer, thank you very much. I welcome this opportunity to speak in this debate and congratulate my colleague Emma Harper in bringing it forward. I have to say, in my short time in this chamber, I've shaken my head at contributions from the Tory benches, but today really beats previous contributions. It really does. As a constituency MSP for East Lothian, which is part of the South of Scotland region, I'm pleased to support my colleagues' calls for Dumfries to receive the city status. I think, as been mentioned before, I was delighted that the local council unanimously supported this bid. And also in the chamber here, obviously, it's been supported by Labour and SNP MSPs. But oddly enough, but we've heard the reasons why, from no Conservative MSP has supported that. Now, most people think they know what a city is. It's large, densely populated, distinct urban area. Lovely old cathedral is a must, as we've heard before, and that's been touched on. As I said, it's been mentioned before, the cathedral requirement is long defunct. That ended in the 19th century. And size of a city doesn't really matter. The bounds of a city status throw up a plethora quirks. There are 51 cities in England, 69 across the UK, including 7 in Scotland, 6 in Wales and 5 in Northern Ireland. Why not Dumfries? Why not? City status, as we've heard, is granted by the monarch. Although obtaining the status does not grant the city any special rights, it is intended as a marker of prestige and can be a symbol of pride for citizens. Yeah, of course.
All of them. I
thank the member for giving way. I just find it very depressing to hear from someone who represents a rural county, that city status is all that matters, that somehow being a city is better than being a rural area. And can he explain to me what you get by being a city that you don't get for living in a rural area?
Paul McLennan.
Yeah, I thank the member for his contribution. I'll come on to that. And I have to say, I mean, if I'm the local member for East Lothian, if somebody came up and suggested city status for Dunbar or Harrington or Trinitrof, I would bite their hand off. I would absolutely bite their hand off, and I'll come on to the reasons why in that regard. So, as seen in Perth, Stirling and Inverness, city status can also bring many economic benefits. And I'll touch on the research that's been carried out on that. Increased visitor numbers and a place on the international map. President Officer, Dumfries is an exciting opportunity to geographically be the first and last city in Scotland. It is also an exciting opportunity to be the first and current only city in the south of Scotland region, and I think that is vitally important. As Emma Harper said, Dumfries is the home of Robert Burns, Peter Pan and Robert the Bruce. Dumfries, and indeed the whole of the south of Scotland region, has wide and expanding areas of forestry, peatland, of outdoor green space, which is hugely important in our fight against both the climate and biodiversity emergencies. Dumfries and the region is also Scotland's adventure playground. And again, this is where it's really important about trying to attract visitors. It's got world-class hikes, cycle routes, lakes, water areas to kayak and swim, world-renowned mountain biking facilities, as we mentioned before, is Seven Stains. The area offers a world-recognised food and drink sector, including local breweries and gin, whisky and rum distilleries. And I'll come on to that. Becoming a city can be great for business, tourism and civic pride. According to... Yeah, of course.
Emma Harper.
Thank my colleague for taking an intervention. I hear the chunterings across the chamber from secondary position, but even if Dumfries applies, isn't that part of what we want. You have to have a forward-looking, aspirational wish for the town, that this is something that people should be embraced, that they should embrace.
I would observe that the chunterings have come from other quarters in the chamber throughout this debate, but Paul McLennan.
Yes, thank you, Deputy Officer. I'll avoid the chuntering and I'll try and move on. And a study led by, and this is the most important thing, you know, becoming a city for business, tourism and civic pride can bring great benefits. And this is research that's been carried out by the University of Reading, who have no interest in this at all. And a study led by Geography Professor Dr Steve Musson, they found that some past winners of city status outperformed their regional neighbours in business growth. This included Inverness and Stirling in Scotland, both in Scotland. Now, this is what Oliver Mundell opposes. It beggars belief. Research shows that city status brings economic benefits. It beggars belief that you're opposing it for political reasons and no more. The study also found that international firms seeking new bases in the UK are likely to favour... No, I'm sorry, not on that point. I'm sorry. To favour cities over towns. Inward investment seeking the best return for their money will be drawn to areas offering large development sites, well-educated workforces and economies in scale. And becoming a city, Dumfries and indeed the wider region may also have great potential to retain the young workforce, because it will bring the economic benefits and provide them with jobs with positive destination career outcomes. But it isn't the only benefit. Becoming a city can also be a source of great pride for the tens of thousands of people living in Dumfries. Just look at Britain's small city, St David's, 1,600 people it has. The benefits of city status are clear for all to see. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I again congratulate Emma Harper on bringing this debate forward. I welcome the opportunity of Dumfries to be the first and last city in Scotland, and I wish Dumfries every success in taking this forward. So it's Dumfries today, maybe Dunbar tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McLennan. I now call Finlay Carson, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Christine Graham. 4 minutes, Mr Carson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. With part of the town of Dumfries falling within my constituents of Galloway and West Dumfries, I welcome the opportunity to celebrate and raise the profile of the largest town and seat of the local authority. But disappointed that Paul McLellan, with his feigned outrage, suggests this has anything to do with party politics, but I'm not surprised. But by not supporting the bid does not mean we don't have the highest of aspirations for Dumfries. The term Queen of the South was first used in an address by a local poet, David Dunbar, who stood in the 1857 general election, and this fitting description has become synonymous with a much-loved town. And generations of my family have worked and lived in the town as hoteliers. But for those who have never actually visited Dumfries, can I strongly urge you to do so, as it has much to offer, not least being the people from the town, known often referred to as Dunhamers, being amongst the warmest and friendliest people you could ever meet. Right from the outset, whilst I may not be a supporter of the campaign, I wish to make clear that I have the utmost admiration and gratitude for the campaign behind the bid for the town to be granted city status as part of the eagerly awaited Platinum Jubilee celebrations. The project, People's Project, led by Mark Jardine, and Mark has said himself, we can make Dumfries and Galloway a tourist destination like the Lake District, and by doing so attract more business to the region. And he's absolutely right. But people don't go to the Lake District because of the draw of the city of Carlisle, but instead the small towns of Keswick and Ambleside with a unique and wonderful rural nature. And that's what the Royal Borough and market town of Dumfries' selling point should be. Quite how the town was founded remains something of a mystery, but the history books actually suggest that Dumfries was once deemed of much importance by the invading Romans. Indeed, many traces of Roman presence in Dumfries and Galloway are still being uncovered, from coins, weapons, military earthware, and even roads. And I'm not sure if the A75 was included in that list. Now, the Queen may look favourably on Dumfries as it has strong royal credentials, with William the Lion granting a charter to give Dumfries the rank of a royal borough in 1186, recognising its importance as a market town and port. And a royal castle, which sadly no longer stands, was built in the 13th century. And William Wallace chased the fleeing English forces southward through the Nith Valley, back over the border. And just for good measure, Robert the Bruce slew his rival, the Red Comyn, at Greyfriars Church in the town in 1306. Thankfully, things are quieting down a bit, and the most famous Scot of all, Robert Burns, moved to Ellerslie near Dumfries and later made the town his home in 1719. So it's 1791. So it's fair to say that Dumfries has a rich historical past, and it would be an understatement just saying that. And we should do, and we do quite rightly celebrate that fact. We've already heard of the list of famous sons and daughters, which would be the envy of many city, but they all came from a rural market town. And we are already on the international map because of that. Emma Harper's motion suggests that city status could bring benefits socially, financially and culturally, and claims that Perth, Stirling and Inverness, as a result of city status, went from strength to strength. I think she's got it maybe the wrong way around. And she fails to say exactly what city status could do to deliver more than a successful rural market town could. I believe Dumfries is a sleeping giant for which too many years have been failed, along with the rest of the south of Scotland, by successive Scottish governments. But now is our time. We have the Borderlands Growth Deal, levelling up funds, and most importantly, the South of Scotland Enterprise, who can really be a catalyst to drive improvements in and around the town. And as importantly, right across our region to the other major town and gateway, Stranraer. Maybe Emma Harper, like her SNP colleagues, are forgetting the Far West and Stranraer too, and its credentials to be Scotland's next city. But it's only through the type of interventions and policies like the Borderlands that we can achieve greater job creation, increased inward migration, higher visitor numbers, and hopefully through the Union Connectivity Review and SDPR2, see increased investment and improved transport infrastructure. Dumfries is already a strong marketing force, offering outstanding scenery, warm hospitality and amenities that make it the jewel of the market towns in Scotland. And that's the title we should seek, rather than city status, which, despite what Ms Harper suggests, currently doesn't have the support of many people in Dumfries, never mind the rest of the region. But what we do have in Dumfries, by the bucket load, is a belief that the town can do better. And with or without city status, we should grab the opportunities we have right now to make Dumfries, once again, the happiest and the best place to live, work and play.
Thank you, Mr Carson. I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Christine Graham. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. How depressing the Conservative contributions have been. Anyway, I congratulate my colleague Emma Harper on securing this debate and support her call for Dumfries in its application for city status, a campaign she has long been involved in. I congratulate Colin Smith, a colleague on the other side of the chamber, also in that camp, and it seems it's only the Conservatives that oppose it. Goodness knows why. Now, I'll let you in. Can I just make a little bit of... Well, why not? So you can depress me again.
Oliver Mundell.
That's very kind and very much in the Christmas spirit. I just wonder if Christine Graham is a veteran of Scottish politics, if she thought this was politically popular, why would she think the two constituency members representing the region wouldn't be desperate to get behind it? The truth is, people in Dumfries don't support it.
Well, actually, they're both Conservatives, and so it is political from you. And I have campaigned on many issues. Let me make a little progress, Mr Mundell, because I think you're digging a large hole for yourself.
Through the chair,
now,
please,
city
Ms.
status
Graham.
Is an enigma. For example, London doesn't have city status, but it's comprised of two cities, the City of London and the City of Westminster. So it's a quirky thing, this status, conferred, as others have said, by the monarch, after advice from the government, but it is the monarch's decision. And again, as has been said by others, it usually takes place on a royal ceremonial occasion, such as the Queen's Platinum Jubilee next year. The criteria is very loose. I won't rehearse it. It's been raised by others. So it doesn't include population and cathedrals. But royal connections, as you can imagine, are handy. And Dumfries has these going back as far as 1186 and William the Lion of Scotland. Then he granted it royal borough status. Then in 1395, Robert III, by charter, granted Dumfries the rights of a town. So this might be another monarch granting rights. While I refer to Robert, let us remember, as others have done, that Robert Burns spent his last years there from 1796 till his death 5 years later, where his body is now interred at the Burns Mausoleum. But I want to turn to Burns' creative connections, particularly when he was at Ellisland Farm, which he worked, which has now got a complex in the Burns Museum, and I've been at Burns nights there myself and spoken. Famously, he wrote Auld Lang Syne there. And I don't know a more internationally known song than Auld Lang Syne, yet I don't know if many people would realise it was written in Dumfries and not in Alloway. Again, Aphon Kiss, again part of the creativity that came from his years there. So, although Burns, when he wrote so much there, 130 songs and poems during that short time he was there before he died, he may not fit the traditional definition of royal, but he was definitely remains Scottish royalty in my book. City status would enhance and remind international travellers of the powerful connection of Burns with Dumfries. It's not just Alloway and Burns Cottage that's in the frame. And finally, on a personal note, what have I got to do with Dumfries and Galloway? Well, I lived in Minigaff, and I taught at the Douglas Stewart in Newton Stewart for over a decade. Both my sons were born in the Creswell Maternity Hospital, now demolished, nothing to do with my sons being born there. Both now Galloway-dians by birth. And I'll always vividly remember the breakneck 60-mile journey from Minigaff to the Creswell in a pretty rickety ambulance with my next-door neighbour, the local midwife, who had to have a stop every so often to relieve herself of car sickness. Thank goodness her delivery skills were not required en route. Later that night, small Angus, all 8 pounds, 3 ounces of him, fell asleep, and I left the ward, and I stood before a floor-to-ceiling window, first-time mum, and looked out over Dumfries in the darkness and lit up by the streetlights, and wondered what I'd let myself in for. 48 years later, with a son now, a father himself, I'm still wondering what I let myself in for. So one of my fond memories of Dumfries is that. I remember that night very clearly and thinking what a beautiful place it was. Now, mine may not be a royal connection, but it's my connection. And again, I thank Emma Harper and Colin Smith, as Dunhamers, for at the very least, whether this is successful or not, shining a bright light on Dumfries, whatever the outcome of the bid. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Graham. I now call on the Minister to respond to the debate, Mr. Lockhead, for around 7 minutes, please.
Can I begin by thanking Emma Harper for lodging this motion? She's certainly been an energetic and feisty champion for Dumfries and the south of Scotland, and I congratulate her on all her work to make the case for city status for Dumfries, which she outlined in her speech. And also, can I also thank everyone else for their contributions to this debate as well. I've learned a lot in terms of the many famous sons and daughters from Dumfries and the fact that it's been a town of invention down the centuries as well. And the way in which Emma Harper and others have sold the town, I think we should all take a leaf out of Bob Doris's book and perhaps book our summer holidays there at some point in the future as well, because they've certainly sold its attractions to the rest of us as well. And whatever happens in terms of the town's bid for city status, I think this has been a good opportunity for everyone to talk up the many qualities that Dumfries has. We have heard much in the chamber about what makes Dumfries unique and a deserving candidate for city status. But, of course, I know that several towns in Scotland are applying for city status, and I wouldn't want, and the Scottish Government wouldn't want to choose a favourite. I have no doubt that all would be strong favourites or strong candidates. And, of course, I'll have to be extremely careful because, as someone who lives in Elgin and who represents Elgin in this Parliament, I have to note that Elgin is also bidding for city status. Indeed, it does have a cathedral known as the Lantern of the North. It also has too many seagulls, which I heard was an attribute for many of the candidates as well. And Elgin, of course, is bidding alongside Dumfries, of course, but also Dunfermline, Greenock, Irvine, Livingston, Oban and St Andrews as well. With this saying all that, of course, today's debate is to discuss Dumfries. So I do want to highlight some of the ways in which the government is already supporting Dumfries and the wider region. And of course, firstly, in April of 2020, we officially launched the South of Scotland Enterprise, our economic and community development agency for Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish borders. And already it supported a range of projects in Dumfries itself, including £4.8 million of funding to support the PPE manufacturing firm Alpha Solway, and establishing a new manufacturing hub there. And then in March 2021, we signed the Borderlands Inclusive Growth Deal, which of course includes Scottish Government investment of up to £85 million in the south of Scotland region over a 10-year period, along with £65 million from the UK Government, meaning a total investment in Scotland there will be £150 million. The project supported by the Borderlands Deal will enhance regional economic performance. They will develop the region's tourism offer, support innovation in key sectors, develop the skills and infrastructure needed to build communities and create jobs, and improve digital connectivity across the south as well.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Minister for giving way. He's missed one important investment from the list. What's happened to drilling and upgrading the A75 under his government? 14 years. The answer is nothing.
I thought perhaps Minister. The Member was going to use the opportunity to celebrate the many good policies that have been put in place to support Dumfries and the wider region. But I think, as my late mum would say, the the Conservatives in this debate, to be fair, have come across as big drips looking for a puddle. And I think that many people will be taken aback by the negativity expressed by some of the members in this debate, given I'm sure it's one where there's some consensus in talking up the attributes of Dumfries. Dumfries, of course, will also benefit from the Dairy Nexus project, which will deliver cutting-edge research to facilitate decarbonisation across dairy farming. And the centre will be based at SRUC's Barony campus in Dumfries, and the Scottish Government's committed £4 million to support this project. And through the Borderlands deal, Dumfries and Galloway will also benefit from £5 million of Scottish Government funding committed to the Seven Stains mountain bike network that others mentioned also. And that investment will upgrade several of the sites and their associated facilities to encourage users to travel across the region and develop a stronger visitor experience. I'll take another intervention.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Minister for taking an intervention. I think there is so much going on in the South West. You've described the Dairy Nexus project and then the Alpha Solway. So there is a lot of investment that is happening in Dumfries right now. But does the Minister agree that even just having an aspiration to apply for the bid is something that could help raise awareness and shine a light on the south of Scotland?
Minister.
Well, I think Emma Harper makes a good point, and that is no doubt one of the considerations that all the cities who are, or all communities that are bidding for city status have taken into account. And after all, this is a competition being organised by the Queen's Platinum Jubilee Civic Awards, which will, of course, announce the successful cities next year. So clearly, that group of people or committee or whoever's taking decisions do feel it's worthwhile for communities to bid for city status. And it's the Lord Chancellor who will make a recommendation to the Queen in due course. So, again, I think others do believe there are benefits to be acquired from city status. I also want to just say, given we are against the backdrop of COVID, that Dumfries has also played its role in the national effort against the pandemic and the economic and community recovery from its scarring effects as well. And Scottish Government has provided £55,000 to the Stove Network, Scotland's only arts-led development trust, to mitigate the impact of the pandemic through increasing skills, knowledge and availability of shared resources for community-led activity as well. Again, our high streets have been particularly impacted by the pandemic, and I think someone mentioned empty shops in many of our communities across the country. And the Mid-Steeple Quarter is a community-led initiative seeking to breathe new life into Dumfries Town Centre by developing a section of the high street as a contemporary living, working, socialising, learning and enterprising quarter. And it aims to see the local community take control of and refurbish underused and neglected high street buildings. Another issue I know that Emma Harper is taking a very close interest in as well. And that initiative receives £300,000 from the Scottish Government through investment from the South of Scotland Economic Partnership and will receive ongoing support through the South of Scotland Enterprise as well. So the regeneration work we are seeing supporting Dumfries Town Centre is a great example of what we want to see across Scotland, and we aim to achieve that through our place-based investment programme. Local people have stepped up with very ambitious plans for revitalising the town centre. They've identified opportunities for bringing buildings back into sustainable uses, and these solutions are promoting inclusive economic development with community wealth as a key theme. So I want to close by recognising the efforts of the people and organisations of Dumfries. And I'd particularly like to recognise the considerable work done by Dumfries and Galloway Council in preparing the bid. Dumfries is, as we've heard described many times today, a wonderful town. It's a strong sense of community and a unique historical, cultural and civic heritage. Its business-based, from food and drink to agriculture to tourism to manufacturing, is dynamic and full of innovation. As it is, and it is, as Mrs. Harper stated, the town of Bruce, of Burns and of G.M. Barry, who based the world of Peter Pan on the gardens of Mowbray House, now an attractive tourist destination as well. So if Dumfries is successful in its bid, it will, I know, become a wonderful city. So best of luck to Dumfries and, of course, the other candidates as well. Many people are working hard to make their bids a success, and I'm sure Parliament will want to wish them all the best.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.